Hi guys, welcome back to Social History Sunday. Yay! I'm enjoying these videos, even if nobody's bothering to watch it. I don't mind, I don't care. So, subject for this week is corporal and, I'll tell you what, we'll just do capital punishment, I think, and then if there's time at the end, we might do a bit on corporal punishment. Got a question for you. We'll start off with a question. Who invented the guillotine? You know that device for chopping people's heads off quickly and cleanly? Who invented it? And we'll come back to that in a minute. Right, so capital punishment, what is it? Well, the definition of capital punishment is the taking of a life by the state in response to a crime. I mean, it's not always in response to a crime, but that's what we're talking about here. Now, depending on where you were and who you were in medieval England, depended on whether or not you would actually get found guilty and sentenced to death, and what kind of death you would have. Now, what do I mean? Well, as we talked about last week, outlaws. Lots of the outlaws were from noble houses, from the landed gentry. And it wasn't very often they actually ended up getting sentenced to death, let alone have the death sentence carried out. And yet commoners were routinely executed for the slightest of things, depending on who they committed the crime against. I mean, the Normans especially were horrible to the Anglo-Saxon, to the commoners. I mean, they thought it was quite amusing to leave the death penalty into the hands of the two aggrieved parties, and they would have trial by combat. But they wouldn't do things like give you a sword or a knife or whatever. They'd give you something silly like a ram's horn, and you were expected to bludgeon each other to death with a ram's horn. And in that situation, whoever lost the fight, even if they weren't bludgeoned to death, were the guilty party, and they would be, in most cases, hung. But that wasn't the only way of being executed. The hanging was actually a follow-on. It was a carry-on from the Anglo-Saxon tradition. That was the most common form of execution in the Anglo-Saxon era. The Normans got a lot more, shall we say, inventive. And again, because justice tended to be localized, even though it was under the rule of the Normans, it was still localised, and the execution methods tended to be localised, and some of them quite humane, some of them quite barbaric, and it depended on where you lived. For instance, if you lived in and around the south coast, like the Hastings area, and you were found guilty of a capital crime, murder or something like that, or if you were a commoner stealing an apple or something equally ridiculous, you would quite possibly be thrown off off the top of the White Cliffs into the sea. Now, the thinking with that was they would wait till high tide, they would chuck you off, and if you managed to survive, well then, there by the grace of God, go I, sort of thing. You weren't actually guilty after all, and God had saved you. There was a lot of God saving and not saving people in the medieval. If you lived in Bristol, now the people in Bristol were, well, not necessarily Bristol itself, but in the Bristol area, were quite nasty. One of their favourites was, depending on how severe the crime was, they would stake you out in the tidal river, and they knew the tides like the back of their hands. They knew exactly how high they would be on any given day of the year. So what they would do is they would stake you out so that you would experience at least four or five tides, and you wouldn't be drowned until the fifth or the sixth tide. There was a case where somebody was actually out there staked out for 10 days, and ironically he actually died of thirst. He didn't die from drowning. But anyway, that's... So, but what they did, they staked you out, and they would chop a toe off or two. They would cut your legs, cut your fingers, So you would actually bleed, not enough to kill you, but were just enough to attract the crabs when the tide started coming in. And as well as being under threat of imminent drowning, you were also having your extremities chewed off by crabs. Very nice people. If you lived in Salisbury, you could actually be buried alive on the plain, on the Salisbury Plain. They did that in Sandown, and a couple of other places where they buried you alive, where there was sandy soil or so. But coming back to the guillotine thing, now lots of people think that the guillotine was invented by Monsieur Guillotine for the French Revolution in the 1760s or whatever. Not so. The very first example of a guillotine, and we're talking a proper guillotine, blade up top, comes down, slices your head off, was 1286 in Halifax. And the reason why a lot of people don't recognise it as a guillotine is because we called it a gibbet. Now a lot of people confuse the issue, like a hangman's gibbet, that sort of thing. A gibbet basically was a place of death. Didn't matter what the method of death was, that was a place of death. So they called everywhere where you were going to be executed. You could either be hung or beheaded by axe or whatever, hung, drawn and quartered. It didn't matter what the method of death was going to be, you were on the gibbet. So the Halifax gibbet, 1286, was the first example of a guillotine, almost identical to the guillotines used in the French Revolution. If I remember right, I'll put a picture, I've got a picture of the Halifax gibbet, or a recreation of it from contemporary illustrations. And during its history, the first guy executed was a gentleman called John of Dalton. Now, the reasons for him being executed on the gibbet are a little bit cloudy, although it is known, well, it's thought that he was part of the group involved in the Southampton plot. Now, the Southampton plot, if it's to be believed, was an attempt to assassinate, or a plan to assassinate, Edward the First. But details are very sketchy. But however, John of Dalton, for whatever reason, was executed, first person executed on the Halifax gibbet, which I believe was in August of 1286. And over its history, it executed nearly 100 people on the gibbet. It was saved for malcontents of particular vintage. The last person executed, again, it's known that two people were executed on the same day, and the names have got a little bit mixed up. But it's believed that one of the gentlemen was called Abraham Wilkinson, or Anthony Wilkinson, and that he was executed for stealing 16 yards of cloth, of finest quality woolen cloth, for which he was found guilty, sentenced to death, and executed on the gibbet. There we go. That's what I mean by it's not who you know, it's what you. It's not what you know, it's who you know. Again, probably he was. I mean, John of Dalton was executed on the gibbet because he was supposedly trying to kill the king, a crime against the king, capital punishment. Abraham Wilkinson stole some cloth. Now it's not known who he stole it from. Probably, considering he got the death sentence, it was probably because he stole it from nobility, somebody of rank, which is why he got executed. Now, it's thought in certain circumstances, in certain circles, that when Wilkinson was executed in 1650, a lot of people started wondering whether that was actually a fit crime to be executed for, the theft of cloth. And it's thought that the reduction in the use of the death penalty started with his death in 1650. And that was the last use of the guillotine in 1650 in England. It still existed up until the 1960s, and it was still brought forward, as it were, as it was exhibited as a historical, but it was never used again after 1650. And some people say that's when the death penalty became less of a fashion, shall we say, in England. Now, the imposition of the death penalty, there was a funny thing happened. Under the Normans, the death penalty was common, and the Normans loved to impose the death penalty on the Anglo-Saxons. Now, once we hit the Plantagenet era, from 1186 onwards, well, 1180s onwards, with Henry II, and the slow introduction of the common, what I like to call the common law era, up until Edward I and onwards, up until the Tudors, the appetite for killing, judicial killings, actually started to wane. So maybe the start of the reluctance to use the death penalty started in 1275, when Edward came to the throne. I don't know. But up until the reason why they started using the guillotine in Halifax was that they had problems trying to find an executioner. People didn't want to be responsible for the death of somebody. They didn't mind watching. When John of Dalton was executed on the gibbet, they actually had to bring in men-at-arms from Leeds to hold the crowds back. There were so many people wanted to attend that it was thought likely that it would actually erupt into a riot. And medieval riots were a sight to behold. Looting and pillaging was the order of the day once the riot started. So they actually shipped in troops, soldiers, men-at-arms from Leeds to control the crowd at Halifax on the request of the local sheriff. So there was and what they started to do is they started to employ a poetic justice. For instance, with the gibbet, if you were found guilty, and it's known to have happened on at least three occasions, if you were found guilty of something like stealing a cow or a horse, and if you were caught with that horse or cow still alive, they would use that animal to trigger the guillotine to execute you, because nobody really wanted to do it. So they would basically tie the cow, and they did this on three occasions, tie the animal to the gibbet, to the trigger mechanism, give it a slap on the rump, and that would pull the pin which would trigger the guillotine. So your crime executed you. And poetic justice was quite popular. You know the saying, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth? Well, medieval peoples in England were highly religious, and they would carry that through to the nth degree. If you killed somebody by chopping their arm off and they bled to death, they'd chop your limbs off. If you blinded somebody, they would blind you, and sometimes do it in such a way that it'd be incredibly gruesome. There were great believers in trial by ordeal, as well as trial by combat. This is where the old adage about witches, they would, if you were a witch, you would float, so you'd be burnt at the stake. If you were innocent, you would sink and you would drown. But you were innocent, which meant you'd go to heaven. So it wasn't such a problem. So there's loads of things like that. It brings back reminiscent of Monty Python and the Holy Grail. If she's a duck, she's a witch. She flew. Fair cop girl. So lots of silliness. But yeah, poetic justice was a big thing. And just to touch on the trial by ordeal thing, I'll do a whole video on the trial by ordeal. There's some interesting things. But they would do things like they would make the criminal grab hold of, this is one of the things they do, grab hold of a red hot iron that just come out of the fire, and you had to hold it for 30 seconds or walk 5 paces. And this would probably actually be done in the church as well, or outside the church, and you'd have to walk from a pew to from one pew to a next pew, or down the precept of the nave or something like that, and then you could drop it, and then they would inspect your hand. And it wasn't the fact that you were burnt that was the problem. They expected you to be burnt. It's how well it healed. If you were not guilty, God would help your wound to heal without festering, without undue scarring, and you'd still have the use of the hand. But it had to happen within a certain time period. And the people believed in this so much, they were quite happy to go through trial by ordeal to prove their innocence, even though most of them got found guilty because their hands didn't let you. Other ones where you had to put your hand in were a vat of boiling water or boiling oil and retrieve a stone from the bottom of the pot, things like that. And they would be inflicted for things like theft. So you stole something, so you had to retrieve something. That's the whole idea behind it. But we'll do another video on corporal punishment, because that is a completely different kettle of fish or bag of apples or can of worms or whichever. It's really, really involved and really brutal. So we'll do another video on that. Anyway, hope you found that interesting. So another